been hired. Okay. And who's ever used the recruitment company? Excellent. Right, that makes it really nice and easy. Okay. So I'm going to quickly run through this. I've got my story so far. I'm going to give you some recruitment insights. I want to learn something from you as well because I am developing the product around this. I'm going to share with you my own learning, and then I'm going to give you some hiring tips, and then you can fire whatever questions you want at me after. Okay, so my career journey. Actually, I don't know if I've given you the old set of slides, actually. All right, well, I have to play it by ear. Okay, so my career journey. Well, obviously, like everyone else, I went to school. Sometimes. I am really not a good product of the education system. In fact, I'm probably the opposite. I was a complete failure at school. And my poor old dad, you know, I started off good, I could read and all of those things at a very early age, and he had a grand vision of me becoming a doctor or something like that. Poor dad. My school days were checkered. Yeah, so I was in trouble quite a lot, and I got into some scrapes. Well, I'm never really a bad kid, but I walked away with very little in the way of qualifications. My poor old dad despaired of me. And as I walked out the school gates for the very last time, my year head said to me, "You're a failure, Constable. You're always, always going to be a failure. You'll amount to nothing. You're a waste of skin."
Aggressive school.
So I flipped him the bird. And in some degree, yeah, he was right in some, because I had no plan. I didn't know what I was going to do. I just walked out there and went, right, okay, hello world, what next? And I got a very short, sharp awakening from my dad saying, if you think you're going to sit around doing nothing, you're in for a shock. Get out and get a job. So I joined the YTS. Anyone remember the YTS?
YTS.
Fantastic. It was the making of me, actually, because I went to Ford Motor Company, really wet behind the ears, and I went into their profit analysis department and crunched numbers. And my job was supposed to be doing photocopying and all of those sorts of things, you know. And I had a bit of a taste for work. I enjoyed getting up and going to work and actually challenging myself and meeting people, and I just loved work. It was so much more fun than school, and I could start to create my own things. And pretty soon I started to teach myself how to do spreadsheets and crunch numbers, and I got more and more involved in the department, and I got more and more responsibility until the end of my YTS tenure came up. And my supervisor said to me, you know, it's a real shame because we'd love to keep you on, but you haven't got a degree, and you've got to have a degree to work in this company. Why don't you go and get a degree? Go to university and get a degree. And I thought very long and hard about it for about 10 seconds. Not going to happen. So I went and got a job at Access. Remember your flexible friend?
Access
in Basildon. Yeah.
Card services.
Yeah, card services. I worked in their payments department, and I had a really brilliant job, which was tapping numbers into a screen. Just tapping numbers in. Now, it was quite good because the hours were good, and there was about 500 people working there, and about 450 of them were young girls. So it was great, and I went there, but then I realised really, really quickly that I got incredibly bored quickly. And so me being me, I thought, well, you know, we're tapping these numbers in, but no one actually asks why we're tapping these numbers in. What's it all about? So I went and asked my manager, and I said, why do we do this? And he said, that's really interesting. He said, in the 2 years I've been doing this job, no one's ever asked why we do it. They just get on with it and do it. So he said, so let me explain it to you. So he explained how the business worked and why we did what we did. And I said, oh, that's really good. Now I understand that. Now I can see the big picture. Here's some changes you might want to make. And I gave him a couple of forms. I mean, this is back in the 80s. And, you know, there wasn't so many technologies around, but I designed some bits and pieces, gave it to them, and they went, that's brilliant, Mark, brilliant. And they awarded me the Quality of Service Award. So my ugly mug plastered all around the business, which was quite embarrassing, but I got a lot of recognition, and that really launched my career. And I ended up working for a new boss, and she was brilliant. Her name was Glynis Egan, and she was a fantastic boss. She really believed in me, and she just gave me more and more opportunity. So I started becoming a supervisor, I started running a team, I ran my own technical support department. I started writing databases and spreadsheets and getting much more involved in IT, and I thought I was really, really good at it. And then the Americans came and did the company. And it became First Data Resources, I don't know if you know. Which was good. I mean, there was some stuff there, but they didn't like my boss and they fired her quite quickly, which left me very exposed. And the new boss that came in, well, she wanted to build her own management team. She wanted her own people in it, and I didn't really figure in the equation. So I got quite despondent and thought, hey, I'm brilliant at IT, so I'm going to go and get another job in IT. Now, I've been there about 7 years. I've been the bulk of my career. So I pinged up a CV and sent it out to some people, some recruitment agencies, and I was waiting for the phone to ring. And I waited, and I waited, and I waited, and nothing happened. I'm brilliant at IT, why aren't I getting any calls? And then one day I did get a call, and it was a guy called Kelly Robinson. And Kelly called me up and he said, I've got your CV here, I'm just going through it, and you know, tell me a bit about this and tell me a bit about that. And I had a really long chat with it, and it resulted in him offering me a job in recruitment. Of course, I wanted the job in IT, he's offering me a job in recruitment. And what he told me is, actually, you're not very good at IT, but you would be very good at recruitment. So I took a gamble, and I left this company that I built quite a reputation in and joined a company called CompuVac. No, it didn't sell computerised vacuum cleaners. It was an IT recruitment company. It was one of the first IT recruitment companies in the country. And Kelly was my boss. He was a year older than me. He was a very, very dynamic, switched-on entrepreneur. So I think he was 26 when he employed me. He was already the MD of the company. And I remember walking in there and seeing people in their mid to late 20s, early 30s, all earning loads of money, and the energy of this place was just amazing. It was fun, it was vibrant. I just remember walking in there and saying, I want to work here. I've just got to do this job. And I love the whole concept of it. You know, you're marrying people up to jobs and you're changing their lives by putting them in jobs. And it was great fun. And of course, this was mid-90s. So it was before the internet revolution. You had to build relationships with people. And so Kelly also very much believed in me, and I took a big gamble leaving Access because I took a big pay drop to do it. But very quickly I started to make decent commissions, and I started to move very quickly into the management team there. And I was a team leader, then I became a team manager, and I just kept going up and up, if you like, into the career side of things within CompuVac. And then an opportunity came up at a company called Oric, which was the sister company of CompuVac. And the opportunity was to be the sales director. So I joined there as the sales director. I turned it around, it was flagging. They were down to about 15 staff. I got them back up to 25, and they were profitable within 12 months when we joined. And again, this was me just stepping up. It was a lot of belief from Kelly. It was really good stuff. I was thinking that I was absolutely invincible. You know, I'm 27, 28 years old. My self-belief is up there. My ego was out of control. I'm driving around in a nice drop-top BMW, I'm earning lots of money, I'm flash.
She made the car.
And it was great days. It really was good days. But then something changed, and Kelly fell out with the owner of the business. He was the MD, but not the owner of the business. He fell out with them. This guy, Roger, who was the owner. He's dead now, so I won't talk about it. And he was a strange little man. He looked like a jockey. He was a tiny little guy. And he was a multi-millionaire, and he was the saddest person I've ever met in my life. The most miserable, horrible excuse for a human being you could ever meet. He was paranoid that everyone was out to get him. I mean, he was the epitome of scarcity. Everyone trying to get my money, trying to get my money. And he was a little bit insane as well. So eventually Kelly said, I can't work with this guy anymore, I'm off. He went and started his own company. And that left me exposed to Roger. I thought Kelly was a saint for having to deal with this guy day in, day out. I took it for about a year of sitting there, watching this guy through all range of emotions, slowly destroying me, peeling me apart, telling me what a useless manager I was. Yet on one hand he's saying I want you to be group MD, and on the other he's telling me I'm not good enough. But that was what I had put up with. And eventually I got to a point where he screwed over so many people around me that I thought I'm not working for this guy anymore. So what I did was I joined Mix, which was Kelly's new company. And I went back on the desk because I was an MD at the last place. I wasn't making placements anymore. I joined Mix, and this was a startup company. It was involved in new different areas of recruitment, CRM. There were new technologies that were coming through. It was the dot-com boom. I got into some big accounts, and again, it was all pretty successful. But there was something not quite right. You know, the dot-com boom had changed things. The internet revolution had happened. And recruitment had changed, the face of it had changed. It was all quick now, you weren't on the phone so much, you were sending emails to people. Relationships weren't like they used to be, they weren't as strong. It was all very transactional. So I stuck it out there for 2 years, I did very well. And then the dot-com crash happened. Anyone remember that? 2001? And it was bound to happen. It was crazy times. People were employing people for twice the salary they should be on just because, well, I've got to build a website. I need somebody to do Java or something like that. Crazy. People lose their heads. And when that happened, I thought, I've had enough of recruitment. I don't want to do this anymore. There's more to life. I want to find something else to do. So I quit. Again, I had no plan. I didn't know what to do. But I knew I wanted to do something else. So I took 3 months out, and I tried a couple of little jobs here and there. None of them really resonated. And I kept getting the same message, which is, well, you should do recruitment. That's what you're good at. You should do recruitment. And I started to feel like I was very much trapped in this sphere of recruitment. I didn't want to do it anymore, but everyone's telling me I should do it. So I met with one of the guys that used to work at Oric for me, and he'd set up his own business. We went for a reunion, and then he said, wouldn't it be great if we joined forces and started this business and really took it forward? And I thought about it, I said, okay, all right, maybe that is the next step. Maybe I do need to be a business owner now. But by the way, that was my midlife crisis. I missed that bit. I started to think about, yeah, what would it be like to be a business owner? It's got to be really easy, isn't it? You just do what you do. Yeah, it's no problem. We started Perfect People. I know, it's a crappy name. It wasn't my idea, it was his idea. We specialised in telecoms, routing, switching, Cisco, all of that sort of stuff. And we put about $5,000 in each. That was my idea for him, was that let's not just do it in back bedrooms and do it on the cheap. Let's actually start a business, let's buy some infrastructure, let's get an office, let's get it going. And we got into some pretty big clients, and within about 6 months we started washing our face with the business. We went through some cash flow issues, it was up and down, but by the end of year one we were profitable. By year five we were really profitable. We were doing really good numbers, and it was a good business, except for one thing. Me and my business partner were completely unaligned. He wanted to go this way, and I wanted to go that way. So what we did was we rowed a lot. We kept on growing the team, shrinking the team, growing the team, shrinking the team. The truth of the matter was we didn't know what we were doing. We just thought we knew what we were doing. We were recruitment consultants with a limited company. We weren't business owners. And eventually, it all came to a head. Because I had my major midlife crisis. And I started to think to myself, well, what's this all about? You know, I'm making good money. My son's just been born. This is brilliant, isn't it? I was miserable, absolutely as miserable as sin. And I thought, why do I feel like this? But I couldn't answer it. I really couldn't answer why I felt like I did. It just consumed me, and I knew again that I needed to get out of recruitment. I didn't enjoy it. And I'd been lying to myself for all these years that I did. But what kept me there, and it's funny when you're talking about, you know, the Alan Watt thing, is that you keep telling yourself, well, you know, I've just got to make the money first, But the money doesn't make the difference. It's about actually enjoying yourself and doing what you love. and I certainly wasn't. So I made a very difficult decision to actually walk away from the business at that point. And I had a very difficult conversation with A, my wife, to say, hey, you know, we've got quite a nice lifestyle. Well, that's all coming to an end. And also to my business partner to say, hey, enough's enough, I don't want to do this anymore. And I walked away with very little because he was a hard negotiator and I had no fight in me. And I actually went through quite a bad bout of depression after that. I couldn't get out of bed in the morning, I didn't want to face the world. I really didn't know what I wanted and I had no plan B. And that word trapped came again. I was absolutely trapped in this world, in this paradigm of I've got to go and do recruitment. And that's all I know. And that was a horrible feeling. When you're told that's the all you can do and that's all you believe you can do. And it's the thing you don't want to do. Anyone ever had that? So, I went and learned NLP. I did some research, so how do I get out of this? And actually NLP was a brilliant way for me to understand that the world was very different depending on who you are, how you view it, and the pillars of NLP really helped me to just rethink and reframe my views on the world. And it started to move me forward, and I got big time into personal development. I loved it. And about that time the phone rang, and it's my uncle in the US. And he owned a company called CAI Cisco. And they help government contractors win very large government contracts by doing strategic pricing and by doing competitive analysis and so on. And he said, look, I want to retire soon. I'd love you to take over the business. Can you come out to the States, learn the business and take it over? Now, because I was still very much in the sentiments of my major midlife crisis, my self-esteem was down there. I had no self-belief. So I don't know if I can. I don't think I can do it. I just don't think I can do it. After giving it some thought, I thought, well, it's something different. It's another job. It's scary. I'm going to go to another country. I'm going to do something I don't know. And I got on a plane and I went out there. And after a bit of time, I really started to get hold of this. And I started to give myself some new skills. And I started to upskill myself, and my uncle started to give me more and more responsibility, and then I built a training division, and before I knew it I was doing a load of stuff I'd never done before, and things that had scared me before were no longer scary. It's the worst that could happen. Just get on with it and do it. And I was finding new skills within myself that I didn't know I had. Unfortunately, what happened with CAI Cisco was that travelling backwards and forwards to the US wasn't a great family dynamic when you got a young son. Something had to give. I also realised that my uncle is a classic entrepreneur. And what I mean by that is entrepreneurs are brilliant at coming up with ideas. They're brilliant at coming up with things that can change the world. They're terrible managers. And they keep you sucked into the business. So as much as I wanted to take over the business, I kept getting sucked back in. So I had to make the difficult decision yet again to walk away from CAI Cisco. And it's just about existing at the moment. I didn't really know what to do next. I knew I loved business, and I knew I loved personal development, and a good combination of the two things seems to be business coaching. So how could I put the two things together? And I'd never really even thought about business coaching until someone said, well, you should give it a try. And I went down various routes and looked at various franchise models. Nothing really seemed to fit that I liked. And one day I went along to an event in London, and there was a guy on stage called Darren Sherlaw, and he was talking about business and how to value it, and I'm thinking, this guy's really got some interesting frameworks and some really good ideas. And I'm scribbling notes down furiously and I'm applying them to all of these companies I've worked in my life, thinking, oh, if only we'd done this when we were a perfect people, what a different business it would have been. If only we'd done this at CAI Cisco, what a different business it would be. And it was really interesting stuff. And at the end of it, I spoke to the guy next to me, and I told him all about my journey, especially up to about my major midlife crisis. And I said, I don't know why I needed to get out of recruitment or why I felt like I did. And he said, oh, let me show you. And he drew the life cycle of a business and pointed out exactly how my journey had been. And that's when I had my epiphany. I wasn't insane, like a lot of people would say, why would you walk away from a perfectly good business? You must be mad. You know, it was all part of my journey. I'd gone as far as I could go with it. I was disillusioned with the whole thing. I needed a new challenge. So my epiphany was, I need to go and use this stuff. I need to go and bring this to the world. But also there's something that's burning inside of me that I need to do as well. And that is to change the world of recruitment. One of the big frustrations I had was I tried to do a very, very good job in recruitment in an industry that accepts far less than that. It's all about scarcity. It's all about being quick. I'll come on to more of that in a minute. So my epiphany led to me joining Sherlaws. I worked with him for 3 years. And in those 3 years, I learned more about running a business than I had done in the previous 20. And about a year ago, decided to go independent and form NextGear. That's what I'm doing now. And Diane, just to give you some credit, as well, has been brilliant in helping us with our back office. I know you like a bit of spotlight on them. So NextGear is the business that we're in now. And myself and my business partner, Dave, both come from the recruitment world. And Dave's spent far longer in it than I did, and he's held a number of roles in that. And he's also got the same vision as me, and that's to change the recruitment industry and the way that we recruit. That's just part of what we do, but generally it's about helping businesses to be better. So, that brings me up to that bit. What is recruitment? Anyone want to give me their version of what recruitment is? Funny you should say that, okay. Well, let's just give it this. It's the act of sourcing human capital to fulfil the immediate and future needs of a business. Is that fair enough?
Yeah.
So there's various ways that we can recruit staff. I'm going to run through these quickly. Words of mouth, family and friends, there are job boards, social media, direct advertising. And then, of course, there's recruitment agencies. Now, there's three types of recruitment company. Okay, so just to give you an overview, there's retained. Anyone know what retained recruitment is? Okay. This is where you pay part of the fee up front to engage with the agency. And then you'll pay them another part of the fee when they give you a shortlist. And then the final part is when they actually complete it and you make an offer and the offer is accepted. Then there's internal recruiters. They're the people that actually work for the company and run their recruitment department. And then there's contingency. Now, contingency is the model that's the most used in the UK. That is where you have, as a client or as a company, a requirement and you put it out to a number of agencies and whoever fills it gets the fee. It's a bit like no win, no fee with solicitors, with law firms, that sort of thing. These are facts. Again, I'm going to run through these. There's 10,000 employment agencies in the UK, over 100,000 people in the industry, 700,000 people placing permanent jobs. 1.5 million temp workers. It's a massive industry. 31.5 billion in fees generated annually. Massive, huge, and growing every year. And that's just the official REC figures. That's the Recruitment Employment Confederation. So what can I learn from you about recruitment? I would love it if you could just give me a few words to describe your thoughts and feelings on recruitment. I think we just got 1 minute ago, didn't we?
Frustrating.
Frustrating, yeah.
Relationship building,
okay.
Time consuming.
What do we think about recruitment agencies?
The good ones or the bad ones?
Ah, right, okay. So let's be generalist.
The bad ones, CV pushers.
CV pushers, yeah.
Pimps.
Pimps, yeah. What else?
There's not the alcoholic beverage.
Anyone else? Expensive for small organisations.
Expensive.
Yeah.
What else?
Unnecessary.
Unnecessary.
Oh, unpersonal.
Anyone got anything positive to say? Sorry, what was that? There was another one.
Unpersonal.
When they're specialists, they're worth the weight in gold. That's all I know. Yeah, exactly. When they're like specialists, like once I'm an engineer that knows something about shipping and there's a special sort of code and you want to find there's only five of those in the world, then they're worth the weight in gold. How you engage with them, track them, and make sure you do all above board about that's good. So I know someone who specialises, he recruited the chief executive of Man City.
Yeah.
And all he specialises in is sports. High-end sports recruitment, and he's working with one of the NBA teams in the US now. He's basically in Surrey, NBA teams, and he's been given a spec, and he's identified, I think, about five or six people who would meet the criteria that this NBA team want, in terms of their next CEO.
Okay.
So
he hasn't got any good manager, though.
And when he talks to me, sort of that, I can see, wow, yeah.
Yeah, okay. So there's a niche.
Yeah.
A niche, yeah.
At that stage, they become more of a consultant working for your business.
Right.
They know every fibre of every aspect of your business as opposed to a kind of a detached model. Transactional, and at that point where they understand you as a business owners, they know instinctively the type of people that you're looking for.
Yeah, excellent. Okay, good. Ken, you wanted to say something?
Well, the negative thing though, it's like a bit of a boiler room situation.
Yeah.
It's that, you know, where they're just basically pushing product as opposed to...
It is very much that. Numbers game, actually.
Yeah.
So, you know, generally the feeling is about recruitment companies and recruitment is that the feeling is generally negative. So my own learning is, it all basically boils down to this. Absolutely nobody likes doing recruitment, including recruitment consultants. It's a pain in the ass job. It's a shitty job. Yeah, what sort of job do you have to do where you've got to marry up two people or two products that can change their mind? There's so many moving parts with recruitment, it makes it an almost impossible job. And no one likes doing it. Hiring managers hate it. Recruiters hate it. Candidates don't like it. It's a thankless task. So that's why so many people try and cut corners. So we can blame the agencies, but actually, a lot of companies buy mediocrity. And that's the problem with it as well. So, let's look at some of the most common hiring issues. Generally, there's a lack of vision and planning. It's normally seat of pants. John's left, quick, get a replacement. Insufficient understanding of these. What did John do? I don't know, pull out his job spec from 5 years ago.
That'll do.
Abdicate responsibility. Well, we're no good at this. Pass it on to HR. They've got a completely different context to recruitment than the actual hiring manager. So responsibility gets abdicated all around the place. Unrealistic expectations and wishes. Well, we want them to do this. They must walk on water and we're going to pay them 10 grand. And the contingency recruitment model. This is the epitome of scarcity. As soon as that role comes out, it's a race to the finish. Quick, we've got to beat everyone else. Quick, 10 CVs over there. What is the point of it? Seriously, why would you go to 8 to 10 agencies and all have them fighting over the same candidate, fishing from the same pool, trying to get a CV to you quickest? It exists because there's demand for it. It's ridiculous. It's useful sometimes, but it's uncontrolled most of the time. And I'm no fan of contingency recruitment, but I don't think it's fair to blame the agencies all the time, because all they're doing is serving what's out there. And there's too much emphasis on remuneration. It's all about money, it's all about the money. We pay more than these guys. We want you to come in and do exactly the same job as you're doing now, and we'll pay you another couple of grand more. So what? Where's the opportunity? Unconscious bias. Anyone know what I mean by unconscious bias?
Yeah.